recognize the molecule.
Mrs. Winasi, sorry, there is no slideshow.
Oh.
The layout is not slideshow.
How about this?
Yeah, okay. This is clear. Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry.
Okay, sorry. Yeah. Okay, as you know, MIP is a technique to create templates of KKT in matrix with memory template. So it is selective, yeah, to choose a component or compound like alpha malostin. This method can be applied to sorbent in SPE or solid phase extraction, and then chromatography, biosensor, and cleanup for biological sample extract. In MIP, here we need a template. We need template, and then functional monomers, and then crosslinker and initiator. It will be the polymerization. Give some kind of matrix that have a specific cavity, and this sorbent we use to SPE, yeah, for sorbent in SPE. What is the monomer function? Functional monomer functional is one of the polymer, yeah, after we use the crosslinker. Monomer is around the template here, then crosslink each other. The interaction between a template and functional monomer is very important because it can be develop the effectivity MIP with good affinity. The functional monomer will interact the with template with functional groups or target molecule, yeah, from template. So it has a binding site of covalent or non-covalent interaction. Selecting optimal imprinting condition are based on trial and error approach. So for choose the monomer function that we use in this MIP, we can give the computational approach. Yeah, the computational design has led the major advance in monomer screening and optimization of monomers template ratio and predict the interaction between template and monomer. So in this computational approach, we can calculate the binding energy. The objective from this study, first is to investigate molecular interaction in the Gibbs free binding energy on the development of MIP. And the second is determine the best monomer to use for MIP synthesis and its ratios. This is the methodology. For the first time, I create the structure 2D and 3D molecule modeling for the template. The template is alpha malostin and six monomers. And then optimization, geometry optimization, and then a pre-polymerization complex template with monomer, calculation for free binding energy, and selected monomer for MIP. I use HyperChem for the subfile. This is the result. This is a two-dimension structure of template and monomers. This is I use Marvin Sketch software. Then geometric optimization. In here, in geometric optimization, I use empirical method or PM3. Okay, from this picture, this is known then that there is a six hydrogen bond donor acceptor, which is a red arrow, and three hydrogen bond donor in black arrow. Yeah. This is a functional monomers that I study in here. Acrylic acid, metacrylic acid, itaconic acid, acrylamide, 2-phenylpyridine and 4-phenylpyridine. This is the pre-polymerization. Okay, in this pre-polymerization, I use ratio template from 1:1 to 1:6. Yeah, in the position of alpha mangosteen, in before this slide, there is a 6 hydrogen bond acceptor. Yeah. I put the monomer in that position and then calculate the binding energy. Okay, this is the calculation of binding energy. Okay, this is a complex template and monomer, 1:1 complex for the 6 monomer. And this is the energy binding for the template 1:1. Okay, in the study, acrylamide, yeah, acrylamide is the best one, but it is different with complex template monomer until 6 position. In this complex, the binding energy give the result that metacrylic acid is the best one. Yeah, give the energy is the better. Yeah, than the monomer. Okay, this is my prediction. This is the template alpha mangosteen and metacrylic acid for monomer that we choose for the best one. In this is the polymerization between alpha mangosteen and 6 position of metacrylic acid, and then we remove the template. So the cavity of the polymer can capture by this picture, yeah. So the conclusion is metacrylic acid is the most suitable functional monomer for synthesis of alpha mangosteen meat at optimum ratio 1:6 of the template monomer, and the Gibbs free binding energy was minus 27.5711 kilocal per mole. This is the references, okay. Thank you. I think this is what can I present today. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much for Mrs. Winasi that only present their research. Okay, this time is discussion session. Is there any question? From the other participant, is there any question? No? Okay. I have one question, Ms. Winasi. You use a 6 monomer, right, in your
yes.
research?
Yes.
Why you choose the 6 monomer? Is there any requirement for choosing the monomer?
Okay. I use a 6 monomer. Okay, there is acid monomer and neutral monomer and base monomer. Okay, some acrylic acid, metacrylic acid, and itaconic acid is three mewakili from acid monomer. Then acrylamide is neutral monomer, 2-phenylpyridine and 4-phenylpyridine base monomer.
Okay. So you choose the 6 monomer, yeah, in your research.
acid monomer from my research. I continue with metacrylic acid ya, acid monomer.
Okay. Anything else for the other participants? The question or the discussion about their research? Okay, if there is no question, thank you very much for Mrs. Winasi to give a presentation. And yeah, we continue to the second presentation. Mr. Indra, can you prepare your presentation?
Okay.
Yeah.
Have you seen my slide?
Yes.
Okay.
It's clear.
Okay.
Yeah.
And my slide, have you seen it?
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Hello all participants. Before I start, let me to introduce myself. My name is Indra. I'm from Bandung Islamic University. Here I want to present about my last experiment, which I get title antibacterial compound from Eczema spinosum originate Tasikmalaya, West Java, against pathogen bacteria analyzed with TLC bioactivity. Okay, this is the map of Tasikmalaya, and the Cipatuja is the southern coastal area of the city of the Tasikmalaya, with its direct face the Indian Ocean. Unlike the other area, Spinosum originate Cipatuja was still rarely studied due to the absence of cultivation effort in the area. And this is Eczema spinosum. In 2015, the Eczema spinosum, or I call it E. spinosum, okay, the E. spinosum production is higher than other seaweed source. It's about 466,740 dry tons. I take it from BPPKP at 2018. Even according to Marine and Fishery Minister or KKP report, the KKP report, Indonesia was encouraged to become the world producer of Spinosum seaweed. And okay, this is the Sigilla dysenteriae, and as we know that Sigilla is a pathogen bacteria that often pose a disease risk for human, especially in Indonesia. And based on Indonesia health profile data in 2018, the incident of death due to diarrhea or CFR case fatality rate was at 4.76%. This percentage was the highest level for last 10 years. And as we know that Shigella dysenteriae is a gram-negative bacteria that cause severe diarrhea. If not, we not seriously to treat this, it can make die. And we call it Shigellosis. And Shigella dysenteriae also has been shown to have resistance to several antibacterial such as fluoroquinolone, cephalosporin, azithromycin, chloramphenicol, and all. Shigella dysenteriae was able to produce beta-lactamase and forming biofilm layers and could perform a chromosomal mutation so that the Shigella make him resistant to the antibacteria, antibiotic. Okay, this is the Streptococcus mutans. As we know, the Streptococcus mutans is a gram-positive bacteria that cause to decay. And here, the graphic, in any group of age has experience with this caries, with this tooth decay because of Streptococcus mutans. And Streptococcus mutans was known to be able to produce a biofilm layer, same as the Shigella dysenteriae, that make it resistant to fluoride and synthetic antibiotic. And actually, we have not found about any information about the active bacterial activity of spinosum against this Shigella dysenteria and Streptococcus mutans. However, in other research, spinosum, based on several research, was known to have pharmacological activity as antibacterial against Bacillus cereus bacteria, Streptococcus aureus, and E. coli. Therefore, based on its known antibacterial activity, spinosum has the potential to inhibit the growth of Shigella dysenteria and Streptococcus mutans bacteria. So, the aim of this research is to determine the antibacterial activity from spinosum originated from Cipatuja and to analyze the active metabolite compound that's against both bacteria. And here is my method, the method that I was conducted. And for analysis the Shigella dysenteria activity, we use SSA or Salmonella Shigella agar, and for Streptococcus mutans, we use media blood agar. Okay, this is the result from phytochemical screening. We can see that the raw material or spinosum contain flavonoid, alkaloid, and also steroid. But in extract, not only the flavonoid, alkaloid, steroid, but also it appears monoterpenoid and sesquiterpenoid. As you know that the component has an ability as an antibacterial. Okay, this is the information that I found about flavonoid and alkaloid. Flavonoid have the ability to penetrate the film membrane of Streptococcus mutans. It's not in the spinosum, but in other material. And flavonoid, it can form a complex compound with the constituent compound of the antibacterial cell walls, and also to inhibit the activity of important enzyme in bacteria, such as tyrosyl RNA synthetase, etc. Flavonoid also can damage the biofilm layer of bacteria, membrane depolarization, and to inhibit the synthesis of DNA, RNA, and membrane protein. So why? When we see the flavonoid in the material, it's a good news for me to get the antibacterial activity from the material, raw material. Okay, and how about alkaloid? Alkaloid was known have active bacterial activity too, especially against Streptococcus mutans and Shigella dysenteria. And this information I get from Su at 2016, where he said that some marine alkaloid and steroid were actively to inhibit the growth of Streptococcus Shigella dysenteriae. Alkaloid were able to damage the peptidoglycan constituent component in bacteria cell, causing the cell wall layer to not form properly. So why alkaloid probably have an activity as an antimicrobial to Shigella dysenteriae. And in addition, alkaloid also inhibit the activity of the topoisomerase enzyme in bacteria. And this is the result of antibacterial assays. The assay of Shigella dysenteriae, and this is of Streptococcus mutans. And we see that the three extract, hexane extract, ethylacetate extract, and methanolic extract, were active to inhibit the growth of Shigella dysenteriae, which MIC at 400 microgram per milliliter. But only ethylacetate extract, which actively to inhibit Streptococcus mutans at MIC to 20 microgram per milliliter. As we see that this is okay. From this result, so we continue the three extract to TLC bioartigraphy to Shigella dysenteriae, but only at the acetate extract that we continue to Staphylococcus mutans. And this is the result for the chromatogram of TLC eluted by optimized LUN. And this is the A is for hexan extract, and B is for ethyl acetate extract, and C for methionine extract. And we can see there are a lot of compound in the extract, and as we know that the higher the RF is the less polar, because this we use the normal phase chromatograph. Okay, how about the TLC bioartigraphy result? In the methanol extract, this is the methanol extract, we can see there are three clear zone at RF between 0.2 to 0.5, yeah, 0.2 to 0.5. This means that the compound was relative more polar than other compound. Why I said this? Because the extract used the methanol solvent, and the methanol solvent can take the polar compound. But as for the ethyl acetate extract, the clear zone appeared at the band with an RF between 0.5 to 0.8. I think this indicates that the polarity of the compound was a semipolar, almost nonpolar, and is because of ethyl acetate solvent polarity. And how about the ethyl acetate extract, which attests to the Streptococcus mutans? We can see only one clear zone, and there that is in the start point. Yeah, and I think this is the semipolar compound. And how about the probability? Yeah, and about the compound, I take the spray region that is AlCl3, AlCl, aluminium chloride. We spray to the chromatogram, and result of the band show negative result. This is for the methanolic, yeah, where none of the compound react with the spray region, but the petrochemical screening showed the appearance of polyethyl flavonoid. This is my analysis that in methanolic extract, there are no reaction with aluminium chloride, but in the chemical phytochemical screening, we can find flavonoid. So I think the possibility of that active compound was flavon glucoside. And as we know that flavon glucoside with sugar at C5 would not react with aluminium chloride reagent. You can see this statement in Harbon in 1973. The flavonoid glucoside have an ability to act as a surfactant capable of penetrating bacteria cell wall membrane. This is only the model, not a real compound. It's only the model, which is this is the flavon with 5-O glucoside. When if we react with aluminium chloride, the aluminium chloride will react with here, yeah, the hydroxy neighbor, but the hydroxy in the 5C that's closed by the sugar. And how about in the ethyl acetate? The spray region assay showed that the band producing the clear zone reacted with aluminium chloride observed under 366 nanometer UV lamp light. We can see in here there are two spots that react with the aluminium chloride. This compound was likely a flavonoid of the flavone type, maybe flavone type, and this was evident by its ethyl acetate soluble nature, which I mean the polarity is semipolar up to non-polar, relative to non-polar, which gave a positive result in the phytochemical screening and with the ILCL3 reagent. So I measured it as flavone. This the structure of flavone, which is the flavone is flavonoid that maybe have a semipolar and non-polar. Okay, how about the N-hexan extract? The N-hexan extract.
I'm sorry, Mr. Indra. Maybe one left meeting.
Okay.
One minute left.
Okay, 1 minute. Okay. Okay. The N-hexan is showed no clear zone at all. Okay. How about the identification of antibacterial compound against Streptococcus mutans, the Streptococcus mutans? Only see in the point spot start, yeah, the start point, and the it's reactive with aluminum chloride. They showed that the compound was semipolar reactive to polar, and I indicate this is was a flavonoid type of flavonol. This is the structure model of flavonol. Okay, this is the conclusion. Spinosum extract was proven could inhibit the growth of Shigella dysentery and Streptococcus mutans, which against Shigella dysentery of 0.44 microgram per milliliter and ethyl acetate, and two Streptococcus mutans at 0.02 microgram per milliliter. The group of compound predicted to have antibacterial activity against the two test bacteria were flavonoid, and some of these flavonoid compound include flavonic glycoside and flavon glycoside aglycon that were active against Shigella dysentery and flavonol aglycon that are active against Streptococcus mutans. However, this compound group need to be studied for the approach, the stage of isolation, identification, and characterization. So that's all for my presentation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for Mr. Indra for the great presentation. Is there any question for the other participant? If there is question, you can directly speak. Okay, I have one question. You use Spinosum from Tasik, right?
Yes.
Is there an abundant the Spinosum in Tasikmalaya, or there is a specific plant or another thing so that you take the Spinosum?
Okay, not really abundant, but in Tasikmalaya there are a few fisheries that but often take the Spinosum and from the ocean and they sell to out of a city, and that's that I make me so interested how to about to analyze about the benefit. But as I said in the front, that in Tasikmalaya actually they are not cultivated. Okay, something like that.
Yeah, okay, I can understand. Okay, thank you, Mr. Indra.
Okay.
Now one question again. Okay, if there is no question, thank you very much for Mr. Indra, and we will next to the third presenter for Mrs. Sri Agung. Mrs. Sri Agung, you can prepare your presentation, please.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Oke.
Okay. Ya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Good afternoon everyone. Today I'm going to talk about MPT64 synthetic gene codon optimization and vector design. And this is our research team. And in the first part, I will explain why we're interested in this topic. As we know, the diagnosis is an important effort to treat TB patient, tuberculosis patient recently, and to control TB spread among the population. Considering that the most severity problems in tuberculosis detection are the similar symptoms produced by different kind of mycobacterium. Not only mycobacterium tuberculosis complex, or we can call MTBC, but also mycobacteria other than tuberculosis, we can call MOTT. Therefore, it is very essential to use the diagnosis component that can differentiate both mycobacterium groups. And the MPT64 protein is a specific protein that is secreted by MTB. So this protein can differentiate the MTBC from the MOTT. And how about the sensitivity of MPT64 detection in Indonesia, especially for clinical isolate of MTB in Indonesia? There are several studies concerned in the MPT64 detection clinical isolate of MTB in Indonesia, and all the study found that the detection using MPT64 are relatively high in sensitivity for isolate in Indonesia. Therefore, the long-term objective of this research was to produce MPT64 protein. Later, it will be used to produce antibodies as the TB diagnosis component. And in this study, to produce MPT64 protein, we use E. coli BL21DE3 as host cell. So we can know that the host cell use is different from the original bacterial cell, the original of the MPT64 gene. And this difference will influence the codon reading system in E. coli. So why do codon matter? Let me remind you that a codon is a sequence of nucleotides that correspond to a specific amino acid and stop signal during protein synthesis. The genetic code is described as redundant, because a single amino acid may be coded by more than one code. So there will be 64 mutation or combination, which consists of 61 represent as amino acid and 3 are stop signal. So if mutation occur, it can alter protein conformation, function, and stability. That's why the expression of functional protein in heterologous host is a concern in of modern biotechnology. But unfortunately, proteins are often difficult to express outside their original cell. They might contain rare codons used in the desired host. So a key step to solve problem is do the codon optimization, where coding sequence for a protein of interest is designed by synonymous substitution to increase its protein level. And in this study, we use MPT64 gene in the form of synthetic gene. We order from Atom DNA2O as the supplier. Why we use this synthetic gene? Because protein and DNA sequences have become easier to obtain electronically through databases than physically from library clone. And then codon heterologs protein expression has been shown to often drastically increase protein expression level. And then by using a synthetic gene, we are easy to design the genetic construct while considering to insert multiple design parameters in parallel. And because we didn't use the original bacterial cell directly, or we didn't isolate the gene directly from the MTB, so there is no risk of contamination. And our work become faster because it doesn't need time to incubation. Therefore, the aim of this research, especially in this presentation, is to optimize the reading MPT64 codon in E. coli BL21DE3 and to design the MPT64 gene in a constructive vector. And here the method we use. We use a graphical codon usage analyzer. We just submit a DNA sequence in a row of FASTA format and choose a codon usage table, and the fraction of usage of each codon in the submitted sequence will be computed, plotted against the fraction of usage the codon in the selected organism. And the graphic will present to show the fraction of each codon compared to the fraction of the same codon in another organism. You can see from this graph, we can determine, for example, encode asam amino acid alanine. You can see here that we can determine which codon has the highest percentage of similarity to encode one amino acid of alanine between two different organisms. For example, the black one is for MTB and the red one is E. coli. So we can choose a GCT to encode alanine. Then the optimized codon translated by BLASTx analysis to obtain an amino sequences. After that, we design the gene construction to be inserted in the selected expression vector. This is the construction of our gene. We use PELB before our gene, because as the signal peptide to secrete the MPT64 protein into the culture medium. So our target is protein MPT64 as the extracellular protein, not intracellular protein. Then we also add EcoR1 as a resistant enzyme. Even in the plasmid we order, there are two resistant enzymes, AP1, but we added EcoR1 in case there is a expression problem and we want to change the plasmid of or the vector, we can cut this gene cluster and insert it in the new one. And the selection of vector used in the study was carried out also using Atom DNA2O application with the specification of expression vector that have high replication ability, strong RBS. We use strong RBS. Kemudian we use Camnose as the inducer and supplemented with Canamycin as selection markers. Actually, the resistance mapping is the additional method just for the confirmation. We must confirm that the enzyme the enzyme, the resistant enzyme used, didn't have the recognition site on our genes, on MET64 genes. Because if they have the recognition site on our gene, it will make the MET64 gene is cut into fraction, and the protein MET64 cannot be expressed correctly. And this is the result of GCOR analysis. We can see here at this figure, it's too small. We can see here that before codon optimization, the percentage of MET64 the MET64 codon frequency was less than 100%. Yeah, we see the red and the black color. The red is for MTB and the black one is for E. coli. There was 31.64% codon usage differences between MTB and E. coli. Here is the difference and the nucleotide substitution. And the optimized of MET64 gene sequence resulted after optimization. The MET64 gene sequence resulted 58.49% of GC content. Why we must consider this value? Because the GC content value is important to be predicted. Because it significantly affect genome functioning. And the GC content of the optimized MET64 gene is fulfill the ideal GC content of the bacterial genome, less than 60%. This is the amino acid sequence after the codon optimization. And we can see here that the BLAST analysis demonstrated that the amino acid sequencing here producing significant alignment 100% with the secreted MET64 protein of M tuberculosis. And based on the result of resistance mapping on the optimized of our gene, there is no restriction site for the use resistance. So the enzyme is okay to be used. Then the design of the recombinant factor containing the optimized MET64 gene produced a total size of 2,990 base pair with complete plasmid like this. And then this plasmid will be further transformed to the E. coli, and then MET64 will be expressed. Now I'd like to end my presentation by emphasizing that the main point is the MET64 synthetic gene can be optimized and designed effectively in the constructive factor to be well expressed in E. coli 21DE3. Okay, that ends my presentation. Thank you for listening.
Okay, thank you very much, Mrs. Sriagung. The interesting topic, yeah? Is there any question or a discussion? No one? Okay, I have one question, Ms. Liagung. Do you use a software, right?
Yeah.
Can you explain what is the software and for what? I mean, because yeah, this is a different concentration, yeah, with my concentration. What is the software and what is the aim of this software? Thank you.
The software is a graphic analyzer, and the function is to make our work easy to substitute codon if we use the different hosts.
Oh, okay. And the software is very helpful. I mean, can we run the research without the software?
If actually it we can do the research using the software, we will have trouble lah. Yeah, if we wanna change the we wanna change the nucleotide. Actually, we can change the nucleotide with other nucleotide substitution using PCR, but it will be more easier for us to construct the gene before we do the experiment.
Okay. Thank you, Mrs. Sri Agung. And we're next to the fourth presenter, Mr. Deden Indra.
Yes.
Okay.
Ada yang sama, tapi ada juga yang berbeda dilihat dari detail dari produknya tadi.
Please prepare your presentation.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Can we start again?
Yeah. Please.
Okay. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Now I will give my research about secondary metabolites from the roots of Amomum compactum, Mibrace, and their potential activity as anti-cancer. Well, in this research, I am as a PhD student of the Department of Chemistry, Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Science, Universitas Pajajaran, and also I'm from Faculty of Pharmacy, Bakti Kesehatan University. As background, we know that Gingibrace contains 53 genus and 1,200 species. It contains many anti-cancer compounds. For example, from Gingiber gerumbe, you can isolate the gerumbone. Gingiber officinale, isolate hexahydrocurcumin, and Gingiber officinale also we can isolate gingerol. And it's proved that there are the potential cancer from the Gingibrace. And from the genus of Amomum, is the largest genus from the Gingibrace. We also know that there's a lot of metabolites up there, such as terpenoid, phenylpropanoid, flavonoid, diethylheptanoid, steroid, benzaline, and cycloterpenol, and other chemical structure. And it is very interesting bioactivity as cancer, antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, and also cytotoxic and anti-proliferative. This is the diversity of chemical structure from the Amomum genus, and that's why I interest to isolate some of this compound from the genus Amomum from the family Gingibrace. Cardamom, if we select some literature, we can find that there is a lot of compound from the this genus. For example, in the Korea, the species Amomum sulco, this chemical content is terpenoids, then benzaldehyde and cycloterpenol, and also bicyclic aldehyde. The other compound is also about terpenoid and bicyclic aldehyde. It's proven as a cytotoxic and anti-cancer by Huang et al. 2015, and Zhang et al. 2015. From the genus, saw that this genus saw interesting biological activity. We can begin from the cytotoxic and also anti-tumor and other activity that is interesting. So the Gingibrace is potential source of anti-cancer drug compound. Amomum also contains benzaldehyde and cycloterpenol with IC50 94.8 and 61.2 micromolar. And it's showed that the potential cancer in Korea, South Korea. Due to mechanism of action, it's still unknown and still there is no publication about this species. This is never been researched before. It is expected to obtain new anti-cancer compounds that are effective and known for their mechanism of action. So the objective of this research is to obtain the anti-cancer active compound of the root of the cardamom or ammonium compactum solar exmaton. And the objective of the research is one, obtain new compounds with activities and mechanism for breast cancer and how to expect to be used as lead compounds from ammonium compactum so that can explore the potential of native Indonesian medicine resources. And the second is as a scientific justification for the use of secondary metabolites from the plant species ammonium compactum solan exmaton as a breast cancer drug becomes a standard anti-cancer drug or phytopharmaca herbal medicine of Indonesia. So this is the research method from the cardamom dry roots, 5.4 kilogram macerated with ethanol, and then concentrate ethanol, partition it with water and hexane. We can find an hexane extract, and then partition it again with ethyl extract, ethyl ester, and then with normal butanol. And every extract, then biopsy test using MTSSA on one of the breast cancer cell line, that is Michigan's on version 7 cell line. And the very active action is ethyl extract. This is the result of biopsy test as the cisplatin used as a drugs as a anti-cancer is referenced in this research, and we can combine with the extract, and we can obtain the result here that the N-hexane extract have the highest activity as extract as anti-cancer, depend on Machana et al. 2011 has publication. So this is the result of the TLC profile of the extract. It is begin with the extract of hexane, and after that, the hexane extract 38.85 grams, and then column, open column with and hexanes, ethyl ester, and ethanol, 20% set twice, and then compacting with rotary evaporator. And then from the deep fraction, continue to column silica and with the hexane and ethyl ester 9.41, and continue again for the fraction D12, and then stepwise, and for the fraction D12B, then continue with ODS column with methanol and water, Socratic, that is 9 combined fraction, and then we obtain the first compound, 71.3 milligrams. And then we continue to other extract, and for the G fraction, G3 and G3AB, we separate with the HPLC, that's a two peak, we obtain two similar compound as DN23 and DN24 as the twin compound. And this is the NMR spectrum or the compound one. This is 3-methoxy, and then this is 2-methane aromatics in the chemical sieve, 6.3 and 0.42. And then this is also methane aromatic in the chemical sieve in 7 and 8.3. This is the specific region for the aromatic proton. And then this is the only one peak that's saw by a hydroxyl from the keton hydroxyl in the chemical series in 12.63 part per million. And then we can combine with the characterization of the peak as aromatic, and then it's also aromatic ring, benzene ring. And for the carbon spectrum and DEPT spectrum, we can find that there is 3 methoxy, and then 2 methane hydrogenated, and then 4 proton aromatic, and then 8 carbon quaternary, and 1 for carbonyl. And this is the data, and this is the data of mass spec spectroscopy, and the best peak we can find is 302.9.10727, and we compare to the calculated mass, this is 329.1025, and only different in 4 decimal. This is so that the peak is confirmed for the compound. And from the data, we can combine all the data, and this is methoxy, and then 2 of methane oxygenated, and 4 proton aromatic, and 8 carbon quaternary, and 1 carbonyl from ester. And if we combine that, we can find that carbon is 18, and proton is 16, and the number of oxygen is 6. So the molecular formula is C18H16 and oxygen 6. The degree of saturation is 11. So this is coming from 8 double bond equivalent from the aromatic, and 3 double bond equivalent coming from cyclic. And this is the flavonoid diprotic skeleton combined from C6, 3 and C6, depend on standard. So I continue to compare with the literature, and then I found that this compound is the have the similar chemical shape with the other compound that is a known compound. This is the position of carbon, and then this is the proton of the chemical shape of carbon and the chemical shape of proton. And the compound of my isolate is 3, 7, and 40% of trimethoxy cyanferol. This is a known compound, depend on reference Cornelius et al. And from the two-dimensional NMR, we can find the data that this is the correlation between T at carbon 8 to carbon 10, and then carbon 8 to carbon 6, and then carbon 8 to carbon 7. So if we can collect this data like this as a correlation of H index, the neighbor of the proton with the other carbon, and then we combine with the proton-proton Fossey correlation, we can find that the aromatic ring is connected each other with the correlation. So this in this okay.
I'm sorry, Mr. Leden. Maybe one minute left.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, with the same way to elucidation structure of GN23 and GN24, and this is the data of proton, and then carbon, and then the DEPT, and then we can collect and the legume maternal terpene cyclotron. We can find the functional group here, and then this is the data. And I think with the same elucidation structure for this isolate twin compound, I conclude that the structure of the isolate is like this. It is only different in stereochemical configuration, and then confirmed by the mass spectroscopy, and then it is confirmed. And as the conclusion, first three compounds as five, three, seven, and four, trimethoxyca and parol, and then 1L, 4S, 5S, 5-isopropyl, 2-methoxycyclopex, 2N, 2.4-diol, and then 1S, 4S, 5S, 5-isopropyl, 2-methylcyclohexane, 1.4-diol, had been isolated from the roots of the ammonium compactum solate hexmaton. And then the second, compound 1, 2, and 3 were isolated from this plant for the first time. Then information about anti-cancer activity of the compounds, one, two, three compounds, again, breast cell cancer, Michigan Cell Foundation saver, was also first reported. This is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention, and I come back to the moderator. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much for Mr. Deden. We still have the time for discussion. Okay. Is there any question from the participant? Other participant? No one? Okay. I have one question, Mr. Deden. Okay. After you success to isolate the compound, did you have any plan to the next step?
Yes. My next step is to obtain the information about what the protein target would correlate in MSF7 cell line as breast cancer. So that's why I will study about the mechanism of action of this compound as anti-cancer. With blood analysis. Yes.
Okay, you will use a computational study or?
Oh yes, of course. After I collect every metabolite from there, and then I will study in structure activity relationship, and then computational docking and molecular dynamic also to enrich the study of mechanism of action of these compounds.
Okay, hope your research is going well. Okay,
thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you for Mr. Deden. Next, yes, we go welcome to the last presenter. Okay. Mrs. Helmi.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Mr. Deden, can you stop the presentation?
Thank you. Sorry, sir.
Is my presentation seen?
Okay, it's clear.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much to the moderator, Miss Rimadani. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, all the participants. Let me introduce myself. My name is Herni Kusriani. I'm from Bakti Kencana University in Bandung. I will present our research with title anti-inflammatory, anti-diabetic, and acute toxicity of Erlangmeyer elater leaves. As we know, kecombrang Erlangmeyer elater is the family Zingiberaceae, has been traditionally used for therapeutic purposes. It leaves are usually applied topically as antiseptic to clean wounds and used to remove body odor. The chemical content of kecombrang has been reported to contain flavonoid, tannin, triterpenoid, saponin, and carbohydrate. Total phenolic and flavonoid content of Erlingera elatior show the highest level compared to other Erlingera species. And this flavonoid compounds in Erlingera elatior were identified as quercetin, apigenin, camphorol, lutein, and so on. The major essential oil of Erlingera elatior leaves consists of betapinen, dodecaen, sesquiterpen, betafarnesen, caryophyllene, etc. And the pharmacological activities of Erlingera elatior have reported that this species has various kind of activities including antioxidant, antibacterial, antifungal, tyrosine inhibition, cytotoxic, and hepatoprotective activities. Among the leaves, rhizome, stem, and flower of kecombrang, the leaf extract was shown the strongest agent against human colorectal cancer cell with IC50 value 170 microgram per milli. So an antioxidant and cytotoxic activity on HeLa cell line. Flavonoid can inhibit cyclooxygenase or lipooxygenase and inhibit leukocyte accumulation in the area, so that it can become anti-inflammatory agent. The effect of flavonoid on alpha-glucosidase activity show that quercetin reduce sucrase and maltase activity in both in vitro and in vitro treatment. This study was aimed to determine the anti-inflammatory, anti-diabetic activity of kecombrang leaves and provide information about its safety in humans so that the dosage can be determined. Saponin and certain flavonoid can stabilize the lysosome membrane both in vitro and in vivo, whereas tannin, saponin have the ability to bind cation, destabilizing erythrocyte membrane and other biological macromolecule. Alpha glucosidase inhibit alpha glucosidase inhibitor is an oral diabetic that work by inhibit this enzyme, which can catabolize complex polysaccharides carbohydrate into monosaccharide. Quercetin flavonoid can reduce sucrose and maltase activity in vivo and in vitro treatment. And the oral acute toxicity assay detects the toxic effect that appear within a short time after giving oral test preparation in a single dose or repeated dose given within 24 hours. And the principle of say that anti-inflammatory activity with a human red blood cell stability method show the ability of the extract to inhibit the lysis of red blood cell as a marker of inflammation. And anti-diabetic activity with inhibitory alpha-glucosidase with acarbose as standard show the inhibition of the hydrolysis of PNPD as the substrate by alpha-glucosidase enzyme. Hydrolysis of the substrate with the enzyme produce yellow paranitrophenol that can we measure with the spectral photometry UV vis. Acute toxicity, the principle of the OECD 420 fixed method, oral acute toxicity test method is classify animal of one sex using fixed dose method. Yeah. We start from the less doses to increase to the higher doses. The methodology of this research, first, we extract the powder of a leaf kecombrang with the maceration method with ethanol as a solvent in the room temperature. The filtrate was concentrated in vacuum to obtain concentrated extract. And anti-inflammatory assay with HRBC method, we use a sample that we have to restock the erythrocyte suspension, and we add the hypotonic solution in sodium phosphate. Then we incubate in the room temperature, and we can measure in 5040 nanometer. Anti-diabetic assay with the alpha glucosidase inhibitor and acute toxicity oral with the OECD method. Using the mice, we use 5 mice each group. We observe the mice at the first 4 hours, and then we continue every day till 14 days. And the parameter toxicity were observed on the body weight of mice, organ weight, level of SGOT, SGPT, creatinine, and mortality of mice. And then we analyze all the parameter. The result of this research that we have found that the present inhibition of the Adlingera elatior leaves show significant inhibition in IC50 71.24 microgram per milli. The mechanism anti-inflammatory is stabilized the red blood cell membrane at the site of inflammation, as well inhibits prostaglandin synthesis from arachidonic acid in a way inhibition of cyclooxygenase. Inflammation is a normal protective response to tissue injury that is caused by physical trauma, noxious chemical or microbiological agent. The lysosome enzymes released during inflammation produce a variety of this disorder. In the present investigation, kecombrang leaf extract contain flavonoid like quercetin may have exhibit membrane stabilization, thus reducing the lysis of erythrocyte membrane. This extract stabilizes the red blood cell membrane, as well inhibits prostaglandin synthesis from arachidonic acid in a way inhibition of cyclooxygenase. The second is the inhibitory alpha glucosidase activity. So the significantly activity, which is the leaf extract of kecombrang, so the better inhibitory activity than akar bose. With IC50 value 42.53 microgram per milli. As we know that diabetes mellitus is a chronic disease characterized by high blood glucose level, deficiency in secretion of insulin, respond to insulin or both. Alpha glucosidase inhibitor are one of The most widely used classes of oral antidiabetics, the enzyme of alpha-glucosidase located in the brush border of the enterocytes of jejunum, catalyze hydrolysis of dietary carbohydrates and convert them into monosaccharides which are then absorbed in jejunum. Alpha-glucoside inhibitors delay glucose absorption and reduce postprandial blood glucose and insulin level. Hence, elevate the hyperglycemia. In the current review, show that flavonoids as inhibitors of alpha-glucosidase enzyme. In the acute toxicity assay, we observe five parameters. First parameter is body weight. From the result, there was no significant change in body weight of the tested animals after kecombrang leaf extract treatment with doses of 300 milligram per kilogram body weight and 2000 milligram per kilogram body weight compared to the control group which was only given sodium CMC. The parameter lethal dose 50 show that there were no death in the test animal either in control group or in the sample group. The LD 50 value of kecombrang leaf extract was more than the limit dosage 2000 milligram per kilogram body weight. The third parameter is organ weight. We observe the weight of the kidney, hepar, heart, lung, and lympha. From this result, there were no significant difference was observed in the weight of this organ. So, kecombrang leaf extract has no effect on this organ, do not affect to the weight of this organ and work system of this organ. The fourth parameter, biochemical examination.
Mrs. Hanley, I'm sorry, 1 minute left.
Okay. There were no significant change in the level of SGOT, SGPT and creatinine between control group and the test group. So, kecombrang extract doesn't affect the biochemical parameters of the body of the tested animal. And this the histopathology. However, after 14 days of the observation, there was no decrease in liver and kidney histopathological scoring when compared with the normal control group. The conclusion of research that kecombrang leaf extract has potential as anti-inflammatory and anti-diabetic, which was shown with IC50 value of anti-inflammatory and the anti-diabetic. Kecombrang leaf extract doesn't cause toxicity at the limit test of doses 2000 milligram per kilogram body weight with LD 50 more than 2000. Kecombrang leaf extract can be well tolerated in short-term therapy. Thank you very much for the attention.
Okay, thank you for the presentation of Mrs. Herni. Is there any question for the other participant? No one? Okay, I have one question. Based on your result in your study, maybe the point activity you see is for anti-inflammatory or anti-diabetic or what?
Thank you.
Yes.
I see the many activity from kecombrang leaves actually antioxidant, antibacteri, and in this research anti-inflammatory and anti-diabetic. And I also research is on the anti-cancer, on Hela cervix cancer in kecombrang too. So,
is there any main activity from the kecombrang?
The main activity, if we see in the community, the kecombrang use for the antibacterial. But in my research, I see the other activity in my study is anti-cancer cervix, Hela cervix cancer. And in this, my presentation is the other of research of in my team.
Okay, thank you very much, Mrs. Herni, for the presentation and the interesting research. And now we arrive in the end of this parallel session. After this, the seminar today is closed, and thank you for joining with us, and goodbye, and see you for tomorrow and in 8:13. Okay, thank you. I will close this session. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Thank you, Bu Rima.
Yeah. I will leave. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Yes.